This video is the second part of the inner ear session, and I will explain about our complicated friend, the hair cells. Before beginning, I recommend watching the previous video, which is the first part of the inner ear session. But if you don't want to watch it, it's fine. I'll briefly recap part 1. The sound is captured by the external ear and hits the tympanum. Here, the sound wave is transformed into the tympanum's vibration and transmitted by 3 small bones, malleus, incus, stapes. The movement of the stapes oscillate the liquid of the cochlea. The oscillation of the liquid causes the movement of the basilar membrane. The shearing movement of the basilar membrane and tectorial membrane causes the deflection of the hair bundle of the hair cell. Until here, the sound energy is still mechanical information, but from the deflection of the hair bundles, their ion channel is activated by gating spring mechanism. And this is the transduction from the mechanical information to electrical information. Okay, this was the part 1. Now, in the second part, I will talk about some specialty of the hair cells and how they send the information of the sound to the sensory neuron. As we discussed in the previous part, the hair bundle deflection is the key for the first step to taking the information of the sound to the sensory neurons. The hair bundles grow very precisely on the hair cells, but it cannot position perfectly for the greatest mechanosensitivity. To compensate for this developmental irregularity, also for environmental changes, they need to have sensitivity. They need to ignore unnecessary stimuli, also tune and amplify the important stimuli. As the hair bundle moves, the inflow of the cation occurs as the gating spring opens and closes the ion channel. This is the process of transducing to an electrical signal. Here, we need to consider the myosin that the gating spring is connected to. Before the gating spring opens the ion channel, let's say the tension of the spring is this level. But when the hair bundle is deflected, the tension level will increase and open the ion channel. Here comes the adaptation process. When the spring reaches the resting tension, which is the highest tension level, the position of the myosin changes, and the tension of the spring is recovered. According to the recovery of tension, the ion channel closes, and the calcium influx reduced to its original level. In this way, the balance between the myosin position change and the gating spring tension is achieved. Additionally, the hair bundle is in a resting position at the deflection position of about 80% from the initial resting position. This process adjusts sensitivity, that is, adaptation to stimulation. In other words, this adaptation process is resetting the hair bundle's mechanical sensitivity. By adjusting the gating spring, the ion channels are kept activated during the resting position of the hair bundle. This is how the range of mechanical sensitivity of the hair bundle can be reset, and therefore hair cells maintain a high sensitivity to transient stimuli while rejecting static stimuli. Let's make more simple. The adaptation of the hair cells means that ignore the stimuli which are not important inputs, but being more sensitive to their input of interest. How do hair cells tune the frequency of specific stimuli? Since the basilar membrane has tonotopic arrangement, every cochlear hair cell is most sensitive to stimulation at a specific frequency. So, how hair cells are sensitive for frequency? On average, the characteristic frequencies of adjacent inner hair cells differ by approximately 0.2%. Adjacent piano strings are tuned to frequency some 6% apart. You can see how sensitive the hair cells are. One interesting feature of the hair cells is that its sensitivity has a longer range than its characteristic frequency. Let's imagine there are two sounds with a frequency of 100 Hz and 10 Hz, and there are hair cells that are sensitive to frequency 100 Hz, which is hair cell A, and hair cell B is sensitive to frequency of 10 Hz. We all know now the sound wave propagate along the basal membrane, so when the frequency of 10 Hz stimulates the basal membrane, this sound propagates to further position of hair cell B, which is closer to apex of the basal membrane. This means that the hair cell's A position of basal membrane undergoes some motion, and the hair cell A also responds to the sound of 10 Hz frequency. Therefore, a detection system of the hair cell needs to enhance the selective sensitivity to relevant frequency, and the hair cell handle very low energy of acoustic stimuli. To handle the acoustic stimuli with very low energy and enhance selectivity that responds to the relevant frequency, they need to increase the signal to noise ratio with two cellular mechanisms, the mechanical and electrical mechanism. In this way, the hair cells supplement the tuning of basal membrane. Since the bundle moves through a viscous medium, the flexibility of its rootlet and mass of the hair bundle and the volume of water play important roles. The length of the hair bundles vary systematically along the tonotopic axis. Hair cells that respond to low frequency have the longest bundle, and the hair cells that respond to high frequency has the shortest bundle. I'll bring the electrical properties to experimental condition. When the hair cell is stimulated with sound of various frequency but constant amplitude, it responds over a broad range of frequencies. However, when current is injected, the cell responds most strongly to stimulation at a particular frequency at which the cell's membrane potential resonates. Here, when current is injected, does mean that injecting the current in real condition, but represents the hair cell itself tuned the electrical phase by the iron pumps and iron channels. This self-electrical tuning of the hair cells help to increase the signal-to-noise ratio. However, it is not clear that this property is the case of mammals, including humans. But in many fishes, amphibians, and reptiles, including birds, the membrane potential of each hair cell resonates at particular frequency. A large portion of the energy in acoustic stimulus goes into overcoming the damping effect of the cochlear liquid on basal membrane motion, rather than into the excitation of the hair cells. So what is the damping effect? The damping effect is the effect of reducing or preventing its oscillation. In a simple way of saying, along the oscillation, the amplitude is reducing. Therefore, cochlea must amplify the sound energy itself, and this is called active amplification. There are two ways of active amplification. Evoked autoacoustic emission is that high-frequency sound are emitted with the shortest latency, approximately 5 milliseconds, and low-frequency sound are emitted with the longest latency, approximately 20 milliseconds. They represent the emission of mechanical energy by cochlea, triggered by acoustic stimulation. The active amplification of cochlea also can be explained by spontaneous autoacoustic emission. At least 70% of normal human ear continuously emit one or more pure tones. This active amplification of cochlea helps to face the damping effect of cochlear fluid on the basal membrane. But if it is overly active, the ear emits sound. For example, microphone howls when its gain is too high. Let's go into more detail about spontaneous autoacoustic emission. Afferent nerve fibers are broadly distributed on inner hair cells and have a minimal connection with the outer hair cells. Instead, a large number of efferent nerve fibers are distributed in the outer hair cells. When efferent nerve fibers are activated, the outer hair cells are stretched and the hair bundle will be deflected. Again, the deflection of the hair bundles, which is the mechanical stimulus, will transduce to receptor potential. This phenomenon causes the voltage-induced movement of the outer hair cells. And this movement can cause de-enhanced movement of the basilar membrane, which leads to amplification of the cochlea. Hair cells form synapses with sensory neurons like other sensory receptors. Their synapses are called ribbon synapses. Ribbon synapses lie in the cytoplasm next to the release site. It is surrounded by clear synaptic vesicles. That's why it calls ribbon synapses. This synapses is the gate of the signal transmission. When the hair cells release the neurotransmitter, the sensory neurons activate the electrical signal. Then why ribbon synapses are special for hair cells? They have unusual features that underline the signaling abilities of the hair cells. As we discussed previously, to adapt sustained stimulation and maintain only transient stimuli, the ion channel of the hair cell need to maintain the activation. The calcium channels of the hair cell are activated at resting potential, providing a steady leak of calcium that evokes transmitter release from unstimulated cells. Next, to release the neurotransmitter from the hair cell, they need to have certain potential level or higher, which is called threshold. The hair cell's synapses must be able to release neurotransmitter reliably in response to the threshold receptor potential of only 100 microvolt, which is low compared to the threshold of the neuron's activation potential, which is normally 50 millivolt. So the hair cell threshold receptor potential is 200 times lower than neurons. Okay, let's move on to how the auditory information flew. From the cochlear hair cells, auditory information flew to primary sensory neurons which have afferent nerve. The cell bodies of primary sensory neurons lie in the cochlear ganglia. The central process of these neurons form the cochlear division of the vestibulocochlear nerve. Each inner hair cell directs its output to several nerve fibers, on average nearly 10 fibers. This arrangement has the consequence of three important results. First, the auditory neural information originates almost at inner hair cells. Second, because of the output of the inner hair cells is sampled by many afferent nerve fibers, so the information from one hair cell is encoded independently in several parallel fibers. Third, each ganglion neurons respond best to stimulation at the characteristic frequency of the presynaptic hair cell. The spiral ganglion cells have a certain pattern. And this pattern also shows in the acoustic sensitivity of axons in the cochlear nerve. This means that each axon is most responsive to a characteristic frequency. Despite nerve fibers having characteristic frequencies, all the responsive fibers display phase locking. What is phase locking? Phase locking is a tendency for a neural action potential to occur at a certain phase of pure tone stimulus. Typically, an action potential will not occur on every cycle, but when it is generated, it tends to occur at the same point or phase in the stimulus. Moreover, according to Volley theory, the neurons group of the auditory system respond to sound by firing action potential slightly out of phase with one another. When combined, a greater frequency of the sound can be encoded and sent to the brain to be analyzed. Therefore, the central nerve system can gain information about stimulus frequency in two ways. A place code. The fibers are arrayed in a tonotopic map in which the position is related to characteristic frequency. A frequency code. The fibers fire at a rate that signal the frequency of the stimulus. Frequency coding is of the particular importance when a sound is loud enough to saturate the neural firing rate. Although fibers with different characteristic frequency respond to such a stimulus, each provide information about the stimulus frequency in its firing pattern. Thank you for watching. That's all for the inner ear session. The next will be the second session of the hearing, auditory central nerve system. See you then.